Good evening.
Good evening. Isn't it wonderful being in the house of the Lord this evening?
Yes.
And to you, those of you who didn't know when we're going to be here this evening, surprise. She has her great grandchildren and comes to our jam all the time during a little skit kind of thing tonight at their church. And then they're having some anniversary celebration afterwards. So just starting their own anniversary a week early. So we'll have to do that.
Yes.
As you look around tonight, you can see who's not here, and continue to pray for them. But right now, I just want to just come and just ask the Lord's blessing upon this service. And you can already feel him here.
Yes.
He's been invited. We're just praising for his presence. He's not his. Gracious Heavenly Father, we want to thank you for all those blessings that you give us that we don't deserve. Lord, we know that in our lives we go through things that we just don't understand, but you do. We know when we're down, but you know how to lift us up. Lord, we pray this evening that we lift you up in prayer, that we can feel your presence in this place. Pour your anointing out upon the music, upon the preaching, and whatever's done here tonight, Lord, we just want to give you honor, glory, and praise. In Jesus' precious name, amen.
Amen.
thanks to the guys that worked over the weekend. Nobody heard that spring of water this morning, did they? Say thank you to Daniel and Daryl.
Thank you.
And it's wonderful that you've heard that for a while, and you no longer hear that for a while. I just appreciate this much. I'm going to ask our ushers if they'll come up with this evening's tithes and offerings. Let's just bow our heads and say, God. Heavenly Father, you have given us so much. And it's with a heart of thankfulness, Lord, we want to give back to you. Lord, we just pray that whatever is given tonight that is used to glorify your name, to reach the lost and dying world. There are people all around us, Lord, that need you. Lord, help us to be about your business and reach as many as we can. Draw them closer to you. Lord, in Jesus' precious name we pray.
Streets of gold.
Yeah, it affects them all, don't it?
Pray for strength, mercy, and grace, and care. And I know you've been taking care of heaven with your mother. So many of us have done that. And just, you know, it takes a lot to just pray for each other. Whenever we know somebody's going through that, just pray for them. It's good to pray for those that are ill, but it's good to pray for those that are taking care of them, too. Anyone else?
I've got a bunch of tests coming up this week. I've been having some heart problems, and I'm praying it's just going to need a adjustment of medication, but I don't know. So, but I know the Lord, like you say, the Lord's got this, and I trust that it'll all be okay. Not doing well. The prognosis is not good.
Dad's not making the adjustment
well. No, he's not.
Remember that whole family as well? Anyone else?
I talked to Linda Sweetie this week, and she's still a part of our church, so she's not here. And she's, you know, gone down a little bit, you know, since she was able to come. She keeps hoping that one day she will, but then something else always goes wrong. She was in good spirits, and her daughter is her caretaker now, and that has given her a lot of relief. But she's, I just like to mention her because when people can't come for a long time, they're forgotten. And I don't, and she's still very faithful to our church.
Yes, she is.
And I just want, you know, I remember her because she struggles. She didn't recuperate from her stroke as well as I did.
So remember Mrs. Sweeney. She's been that part of this church for many years. And like I said, since even though she's not here, she still faithfully comes by and drops her envelope in the mailbox. Supports the church the best she can, and I appreciate that very much. Appreciate that anybody that says that puts God first, even in her illness.
She watches the online services, so.
And you watch it.
Yeah.
Religiously watches the online services. There's nothing else than we'll sing a prayer for us. Last week, she could come and lead us in prayer.
Thank you.
Yes, it does.
Praise his name. Richie, come here. Please do it, brother.
Good evening.
Now, he mentioned a thought popped in his head. That can be dangerous sometimes, you know? I thank you tonight of a situation in which that happened. I was scheduled to preach for the first time at a church that Amber and I had just begun to attend for just a few months. And, weren't familiar with the people yet, really, you know. We're still new. Joy, I'm sorry. I know you got to chase me tonight.
No, you're fine.
And sweet gentleman, a pastor who's older than me and been friends with my grandfather. A nice situation to be in for a season. It was so long ago that my 15-year-old son was just a few inches long. rather than a few feet long, you know what I'm saying? He'd just been born, so we were everybody's favorite couple when we came to church because they all wanted the baby. You know how that goes. First time I was scheduled to preach, and we were sitting. I had a difficult time sitting in the back of the church, just because I watch people, and when I'm in the back, I want to watch people to see how they're responding, to see if they're in the same place I am. And unfortunately, we have horrible habits in church. And then I get distracted and frustrated. So long ago, I decided I'd sit in the front. So we were sitting about the second or third pew, which is our norm. And we're sitting there probably 5 or 10 minutes at best before I'm scheduled to perform, getting ready in the pulpit. And that sweet, loving wife, I said, I can't tell this story when she's here. She doesn't like when I talk about the pulpit. She ain't here, so I get away from her. Looks up at me and says, now you understand, this was, at that time, this was probably the quietest church I ever attended on Great Crisis. It's okay to be quiet. No problem with being quiet. I'm not quiet. But I understand that people worship quietly. We all worship in a different fashion, and that's okay. We all express ourselves in different fashions, and that's okay. That's what we're supposed to do, right? What I have a problem with is when we act like David's wife, Michael, and tell other people how they should worship and how their worship should look like our worship or their worship is wrong. That's when it becomes an issue to the church, right? It's when we clash. But they were a quiet bunch, and some of them all knew young adults that were Christians, and they were just learning how to praise worship. And it was so quiet. This night was so quiet. And you just feel that there was something the Spirit was trying to move. You know what I'm saying? And the people just either weren't moving with it or didn't know how to move with it. And I'm still not sure which one it was. But 5 minutes before I'm supposed to preach, my beloved wife, bless her, looks over at me and says, Richie, have you ever seen that before? Don't you love it when someone starts a conversation in the middle of a thought? Or in the middle of a conversation that you're not a part of? All you men are nodding silently, I know. Anyways, I said, what are you talking about? And she points to the right-hand side, probably smaller congregation, smaller sanctuary. So about here, from the pulpit, on the wall hangs a fire extinguisher. She said, I've never seen a fire extinguisher in a sanctuary before. And in my head, I immediately began to chuckle. What could happen? Now I was thoroughly distracted. And then the Lord came in and sat down with me and said, now, what are you going to preach? Well, I had my notes. I had my Bible in my hand. And I don't do well without notes because I'm kind of scattered. Wilma can come up here, she's got these 5 points or however many points in her hand, and she just count them off. Because this money works differently. You know? There's a whole jungle of whirlwind and typhoon taking place up here. And if I don't have something to remind me where I've been, where I am, and where I'm going, you don't know what's going to come out of this guy. So that's why I keep notes. So I said, Lord, you run ahead of me. He said, oh, you studied, yes. And you wrote something down. Is that what I gave you? I said, well, I thought it was, or I would have wrote it down. And there's this conversation as I'm sitting, second row, 5 minutes to go, now we're down to about three. I said, okay, well, let me find what you're trying to tell me. So I started flipping for a particular scripture. I never did find the scripture. I said, all right, well, if I can't find a scripture, I'm changing my sermon. I get up to preach. I couldn't get a word out of my mouth. And the old preacher, sitting over here on my right, right to the pulpit, looks up and says, son, what has the Lord changed and where is he taken? Let me help you. He recognized, you know what I'm saying? I assure you, this is going someplace. I ain't sure where, because the hint is this. He said the same thing to me tonight, okay? So, I get up and begin to find this scripture, and I finally find it. Quench not the spirit.
Yes.
Quench not the spirit. And the Lord began to speak through me about the fire extinguisher 2 feet from the pulpit, 2 feet from the altar. And I sort of just said, you know, I think spiritually this is a picture of what y'all have happening. That every time the Spirit begins to move like he did that night, someone's dampening it out, putting it out. I was talking a few years ago with a minister friend of mine who was sharing that story, and we had several good laughs about it because he had some things like that happen and we passed some things back and forth. The gist of our conversation about that thought of putting those things out was this, that we both can say we've seen a lot of churches like that in our times. Churches that seem to have almost forgotten how to move when the Spirit moves. That's an indictment against us, you know that? And then there are people who don't move when the Spirit moves. I don't know that I've ever preached what I'm going to say this next point, but I've said it many times. I've just never said it on a pulpit. In the 1980s, when I grew up, I remember this, I guess, when I said the 80s, but during the Cold War, when the United States and Russia were the only two true world powers, and they both had the ability to wipe out the world with a few pushes of buttons. Mutual destruction, right? The United States government came up with a political theory or a political action military theory that basically said this. If someone does something against us, we'll respond with a measured response. An appropriately measured, predetermined response when someone does something against us. If you're as old as me, you can think back to different climes and places where we've done those things. Whereas a government, someone took an action against us and we measured our response. It was enough to get the point across. It was enough to get the job done. But it didn't end things forever. And so then there was no mutual response back. Can I tell you that somewhere in my spirit, I feel like many Christians have developed a similar response to the Holy Spirit? It's this thought that when the Spirit moves, raising my hand. I am comfortable whispering an amen. I am comfortable giving a small clap. I will acknowledge that the Spirit of God is moving, but I will only go so far before I stop. Because I don't want to be carried away praising the Lord. I don't want to be carried away. I want to have an appropriate response of praise and of worship to the Spirit of God. There's a few issues with that thought. One, God wants us to get carried away.
Amen.
Now let me be specific. I'm not talking about being carried away in a way that brings confusion, because God's not the author of confusion.
Right.
I'm not talking about being carried away in a fashion that is, I don't even want to say I'm dignified, because then that makes it sound like praise and worship is undignified. And I'm going to be honest, the only time I find praise and worship undignified is when it doesn't happen when it should.
Right.
That's when praise and worship is undignified, because then it's not happening according to the will of God. It's happening according to the will of people, the will of man, and the will of woman. And that's what the enemy wants us to do. He wants us to have an appropriate response to the Spirit of the Lord. He doesn't want us to have a carried away response to the Spirit of God. Here's why. Several reasons. But the number one thing I'm thinking of is this. When my grandfather, we will get to some scriptures, I promise. When my grandfather, this is a big story. I'm trying not to be able to tell stories tonight. This is the Lord's God. My grandfather was, his father was murdered at 3. His house burned down when he was 5. His mother died by the time he was 8. By the time he was 12, he was living on a creek bank by himself with no family. He had adult brothers and sisters. He was the youngest of a bunch of 9 or 10 that survived, but none of them had the financial ability to care for an extra child other than the ones they had. So he said, I'm just going to go live on my own river. His favorite place to sleep during the summer, the cemetery, because the snakes let you swallow a lot of stuff and they were cool. In the rain, he went to town, in the little town garrison, slept underneath the church on it because it wouldn't rain on him. It's a whole lot different than the things I got to think about during the summer and the rains. Went to the Navy. He decided there was no God. He went to this little church. It was there local when he went in. He said it was the same people acting crazy on Sunday morning that he just partied and drank with on Friday night. So to him, it wasn't real. Years go by, he's married. He got 2 or 3 kids. He married this little Southern Baptist woman from Firebrand. He never lived in Columbus, Ohio. Starts working with this man who's a Christian, who's 24, 25, grandpa's 30, and he's a minister. This man begins to witness to him on the line while they're painting caskets every day. To the point where one of the men chased him into the paint booth and had to lock it from the inside. And poor Lee was in there shaking because this fellow was going to whoop him all over the planet. Because he wouldn't stop talking about Jesus this day. My grandpa's response was, he said, well, I'll tell you what, Lee, when you get a church of your own, I'll come here to preach. Grandpa figured, well, nobody done enough to get some hillbillies from Primary, a church to pass into the club. So honestly, say, guess what? Christian Christ and Christian Union was that bunch of people that did it. I tried to say that delicately. Same time, my grandma knew that their lives weren't right. Grandpa was bordering on being an alcoholic. He was definitively weak and drunk. He was spending all their money on gambling, booze, not able to pay their bills. She'd been raised in church. She had shared his views. And they started going past this church that was just down the road from him. And every time they passed it, she'd say, Mark, I'm just a little hillbilly from Kentucky. And I couldn't go to some big church up here in the city, but you could find me a small little church like that, a country preacher, and somehow I'm getting in my kids in church. I love my kids, Georgia, but I'm getting in my kids here. Time passes, and she said, every time she passed that church, she'd say, just something like that, Lord. Just something like that. Eventually, it said they gave this man a church pastor. He was having a revival. He shows up at Grandpa's on a Saturday and knocks on the door and says, George, I'm here to see if you're a man of your word. You said you'd come, they'd give me a church. I expect you next week. Grandpa said, I'm a man of my word. They show up at the church, and to my grandma's shock, it's the very church that she'd been passing for all those months. Say, Lord, you could find me a little church like that, a little country pastor like this. Aren't you glad the Lord hears us?
Amen.
She rolled in there. First night, they were there with their two best friends, another gentleman that worked with Grandpa, who was in the same condition of life. And now, my understanding of that little church, the name of it is Joe Heights, it's still there in Columbus, was that they were completely wild. I mean, completely wild. They run the aisles, they shouted, they ran the backs of pews, they done cartwheels, I don't know what all they done. But I know this, 30 years later, 40 years later, I was attending a church in Columbus, and our denomination was all up arms because we were out of control with our praise and worship, and we were doing all these things that were supposed to be done. We weren't doing any of those things. So Grandpa came up to see what's happening. He went to see for himself. On the way out the door, I know that Disco Bob was there, because this fellow had done this all day long. Honest to goodness, he praised the worship like this. He couldn't walk. He drove his right leg everywhere he went. He'd been in a car accident, completely crushed his right leg. Hadn't been able to walk right for 30 years or something like that. But he could bust a new carpool across the pool, all the way across the stage. He'd run up the steps and down and jump. And, oh, I mean, it was crazy. I loved it there. Grandpa come, and all those types of things that happened on this night. And on the way out, he pulls me over. He put his arm around me and said, well, I see what I need to see tonight. I said, what are you talking about? So he told me why I was there. And he said, this is all I'm going to say to you. If this punch was God, it's a good thing that I was around these young guys. And he got his car and he goes, oh. Grandma got saved the first time. That revival, the Lord told her, if you'll go, the rest of them will be saved before the end of the week. She said, well, I don't know that I believe that, but I believe I need to get saved, so I did. One by one, they got saved. After the first time, when Grandma got saved, Grandpa was already in the car, Grandma came out and got in. And he said, if that's the kind of bunch of nuts you want to go to church with, I'll drop you off at the front door, pick you up at the back, and I will never darken the steps again. The emotional crush, nobody can act like that. Bunch of fools. Tuesday night, come, Grandpa back to church. Wednesday night comes, Grandpa's back at church. Thursday night comes, Grandpa's back at church. And all that happened for this one thing. That little old country pastor come running out part of the meeting before he left. He said, now, George, I just want to let you know, if you don't want to have a great pack to church, I'll come pick her up at your house and bring her home. And Grandpa said, ain't no man drive my wife nowhere. Me, I'll be here tomorrow. By Friday night, Grandpa got saved. But the thing that caught his attention was that there was a fire in the church. There was a presence of God that came that was intense and genuine. And there was a response from the people that was intense and genuine.
Amen.
I'm not so sure we have those things any longer than the average church in America. I'm not sure there's fire left. I believe the embers are there. I believe there's some nice logs over here ready to be put on that fire. But I believe the embers are so, so burnt down now that if they put the big stuff on it, smother. And be out again by next week. Because we've not been tending the fire.
All right.
I think, you know, the book of James, it says, draw nigh unto God, and he'll draw nigh unto you. I think a lot of us draw nigh, but never get close. That makes sense?
Yes.
We're comfortable with a certain distance between us and the Spirit of God. We want to get close enough to feel his presence.
Yes.
To get his touch when we need it. But we don't want to move in with him and live with him. We don't want to stay there with him. We want to visit the book of Matthew. Chapter 27, verses 50 through 53. Say this. Jesus, when he cried again with a loud voice, yielded up the ghost. Behold, the veil of the temple was red flame from the top to the bottom, and the earth did quake and the rocks rent, and the graves were opened, and many bodies of the saints which slept arose, and came out of the grave after his resurrection. And went into the holy city and appeared unto men. Now there's a whole lot of those few verses. But the part I want us to focus on today is that second verse, which says, behold, the veil of the temple was rent in twain from the top to the bottom.
Yes.
And the earth did shake as the rocks rent. You know, God, when he set up the Mosaic law, the Mosaic tradition, he had them build the ark. The ark was a box. And in that ark were the things that represented God. Mm-hmm. And the mercy seat was there. That was where God came. The Spirit of God came and sat on it. And met with Moses. Did God constrain himself to that box? And he constrained himself to that place of holy of holy. Then come the day of Christ's crucifixion. And I don't know if it was the Spirit of God. I don't know if it was the hand of God, the same hand that wrote the Ten Commandments upon the tablets, or if it was something that he sent down. But some force came down and wrapped a hold of that curtain. And now let me just take a moment in case you're not aware. When they talk about a curtain, they're not talking about a flimsy piece of cloth. This curtain was inches thick, was braided and twined, and was specially made for the purpose of representing a separation between the Holy of Holies and those who would enter and those on the outside. He couldn't peer through this veil. Higher than our ceilings, or about as high as the ceiling here, so an old man was reaching up and grabbing it for the top and pointing it down. But it says the garment was rent in twain from top to bottom. The book of Ezekiel tells us there was become a day when the Spirit of God was going to rush forth from there and spread out into the world. This was the fulfilling of that prophecy. Folks, God got a whole lot of work to get out of that box.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
We've done a whole lot of work since to try and put him back. To constrain him, to limit him. And I don't think we constrain him in limitable purpose. I think we have a desire to see the works of God. I'm just not sure we have a desire to do the things required to have the works of God. sure we're going to live our lives with the amount of prayer it takes and the amount of Bible it took for the apostles to live as they lived. I'm not sure we have a desire to be fully holy anymore in our holiness movement. To strive to live pure before our God. And even the majority of those who do it from a legalistic perspective and not from a spiritual perspective. It's about keeping the rule of law rather than keeping the Spirit of God, the love of God. Christ said, you follow my law because you love my Father, not because I wrote it. In other words, if you love me, what do you say? You'll keep it. You'll do it. Mm-hmm. It's not a matter of desiring to be more obedient. It's a matter of desiring to love God.
That's right.
I feel like I've been all over the place this evening and haven't done near the job I needed to do. I'm going to head towards the close here. There's a story that there was a man who was studying abroad in Great Britain in like the 30s, 40s. I think it would have been maybe the 50s anyways. He was studying there abroad in London. He'd come from a foreign country there, and he had a very different upbringing and never really experienced Jesus. And in his mind, he was wondering if this Jesus he heard so much about was real. And his days of studying abroad had come to an end. And he was preparing to go back home. And he decided while he was there in London, he was going to find a church to go and take in a service. See what there was about this Christ. What there was about this move of God. And he went to a church, just an average local church, and he sat down, and later in a biography and an autobiography, he would say this. He didn't see anything special there. There was no great move of God. There was no weeping. There was no praising in the aisles. There was no fire in the people. There was nothing great that came from the pulpit of the sinners. It's just an average day. And he experienced nothing. And he left, I think it was like every other religion he experienced. Hollow, shallow, and missing what he was searching for. So Mahatma Gandhi went home to India and decided he'd be a Hindu after all. Because when he decided to go see Christ, he couldn't find it in his own house. He'd been absent. His own house. Not because God is slack, but because somewhere along the line we lost our desire to see the fire of God fall.
Yes.
Before the altar of the Lord. I'm sure there were good people in that little church. I'm sure those people have no idea. I don't believe that they necessarily committed a great crime against Christ. Well, I wonder how many people come into our churches and are left thinking, blah, as my son would say at 15. Yeah. We're not talking about entertaining people. We're not here to entertain people. We're here to reach people. We're here to get conduit through which Christ can change people, through which he can transform people. Are we responding to God? Are we still seeking after God? Or are we putting a lid upon the whole I read the scriptures that the new temple of the Lord is a person. We are his temple. We are his holy of holies. We are where his spirit dwells. We are where his spirit breathes. We are where his spirit speaks. So how are we responding to that spirit? Are we doing it with love? Are we doing it with obedience? Or are we coming together in one accord with one another? Without opposition between us? With a mindset to praise and worship God? Usually when I speak this, we talk about this particular scripture, talk about this concept, I talk a lot about praise and worship are a response to who and what God is. Praise is recognizing the things he's done for us. The cross, the grave, Easter morning, leaving the throne of heaven, coming down, and being coming back, walking among us, teaching us, living with us. Worship would be the nature of God, which is holy. It means he's other than us, he's beyond us, he's more than us. His nature is perfect and without flaw. Without flaw. His spirit is constantly striving and serving, searching to find those who would come to Christ. But praise and worship are more than an internal feeling. It needs to be an internal spiritual habit. And habits require response. And responses require some sort of external demonstration. Some sort of external acknowledgement of his movement. Some sort of external demonstration of who he is, of what he's done. And I think they require more than the average, because he's more than average.
Yes.
Personally, I think he deserves more than the measured response. But he deserves our full response.
Yes.
My all on the altar of sacrifice. I'm going to close with this strange thought. There's this church that Amber and I have had the great privilege of visiting on occasion. And the last time we were there, Amber let me on a little inside joke about them in our family. But we referred to them as the Thunderdome. When we told the children we were going to church that, we would tell them we're going to the Thunderdome today. And they were like, "What in the world is a Thunderdome?" Well, a Thunderdome is a reference to several things, but basically it means there was thunder in their church. There was a vocal responsiveness to the move of God in their church. There were people in action, and there were people doing, and there were people on the altars, and there were people shouting. And then there's this one lady who was homeless for a while. And after homelessness got saved, and out of that position, she found a husband, and she's in her probably 50s or 60s, and then she found a home to live in. And let me tell you something, she worships God with a passion.
Praise the Lord.
And she's got this little woo-woo-woo-woo thing she does, where she pumps her fists and sort of shouts a little bit. And I told Amber a couple weeks ago, I said, I think I'm a little down. I think I need to go visit our friends at the Thunderdome to get your ride back up a little bit. But I don't say that to mock them. I say that because I believe there are people who have had a history. They've been brought from something, and it's recent enough that they still remember what they were brought out of.
Yes.
And they're not, and they're celebrating what they were saved from. Yes. They're celebrating the depth of sin that they were in, the height of glory that they had come to. They have let God out of the box.
Amen.
And they're letting him roam freely. But as I do that, I want to leave you with this question. Are you letting God out of the box? Are you letting him roam freely? And are you responding when he moves upon you? If not, come and tell him you will. And if so, praise him like you are. Your precious Lord, oh gracious God, oh mighty Spirit of the living God, oh Son of God, beloved and begotten, the call upon you this evening. Let us be aware of the pitfalls of walking the lead upon the box of all. God, let us not quench the Spirit by not responding, but not doing, by lacking obedience. Oh Lord, bring the waters with a fresh wind from the Holy Spirit. Renew us, revive us. Instill within us that still small voice. Holy Father, oh glorious God, almighty Lord, we thank you, Jesus, for all that you do, for all that you are, for all that you can do. Oh, praise be thy name, Jehovah. Oh, glorious are thy ways. Mighty art thou, King of kings. Humble art thou, O Lamb of God. Mighty art thou, our protector, O Lion of the tribe of Judah. O good shepherd.